Saint John predicted the last great battle on earth would take place at this sun scorched hill, better known as Armageddon, Revelation 16:16. Aside from scuttling lizards, all quiet today. Walking trails connect remnants for more than 25 distinct historical periods from 4000 BC to 400 BC. Only rubble remains of prayer structures and water cisterns through a 15-minute introductory film and signposting offer tantalizing historical details. There are expansive views too. You'll see the four horsemen coming from miles away. Megiddo has been the scene of many battles throughout the ages. Hieroglyphics on the wall of Karnak Temple in Luxor, Egypt describe a battle in which Thutmose III quashed a rebellion at Megiddo in 1457 BC. Megiddo remained a prosperous Egyptian stronghold for at least 100 years and later on held out against the Israelites. It's found in Judges 1:27. Probably only falling to David under his son Solomon, Megiddo was transformed into one of the jewels of the Israelite kingdom and became known as the Chariot City. Excavations have revealed traces of stables extensive enough to have held thousands of horses. Megiddo is 37 kilometers southeast of Haifa along routes 75, 70, and 66, 45 kilometers east of Caesarea via route 65, and 13 kilometers southwest of Afula in the Jezreel Valley. In frequent bus 300 from Haifa Merkezit, Hamifrat's bus station takes 40 minutes to reach the intersection of Route 66 and Tel Megiddo. It's a short walk to the site. By car, it's an easy halfway day trip from Haifa, Caesarea, or Zikron Yaakov. Megiddo, an impressive site in the Lower Galilee region of northern Israel, was once an ancient city, was critical that dominated the Aruna Pass, Wadi Ara, or Megiddo Pass, the entrance to one of the few passes through the Carmel Mountains. This gave those who occupied Megiddo incredible power over the Via Maris, the main route between Egypt and Mesopotamia, and what the Egyptians called the Way of the Sea. Today, Megiddo is a UNESCO World Heritage Site and an impressive site to visit and explore. The city has seen more battles than any other location in the world. Fortress cities sit upon the 10-acre summit of Megiddo Hill, or Tel Megiddo, rising 21.33 meters above the valley. From this vantage point, battle after battle throughout history took place. For Christians, the word Megiddo is synonymous with the end of the world. As mentioned in the book of Revelation, Megiddo or Armageddon will be the site of the final battle. This will be the final battle of many fought here. Excavations has uncovered about 26 layers of settlement dating back to the Chalcolithic period. The first four layers have been identified. The hilltop was a Canaanite city, an Egyptian fortress, a chariot city during biblical times, and a prominent Assyrian and Persian city. King Solomon ruled the city in its prime in the 10th century BC. Visitors can see the remains of Solomon's gate and his stables. The Ivory Palace is another major structure in Megiddo. It was here they located Canaanite treasure, including valuable ivory and jewelry. In the Middle Bronze Age, the Canaanites fortified the hilltop and a gate remains from the 3rd millennium BC. You can see an altar 10 meters in diameter with a staircase leading up towards it. Tel Megiddo National Park was officially declared a national park in 1966. In 2005, the UNESCO inscribed Tel Megiddo as a World Heritage Site together with the biblical tales of Hazor and Tel Beersheba. At 190 dunams, 47.5 acres, Tel Megiddo National Park encompasses the archaeological mound of Megiddo, which has an area of about 60 dunams, 15 acres, and rises above 60 meters above its surrounding. In addition to the settlement on the upper part of the archaeological mound, remains of a lower city were found to the northeast near the entrance to the site. A possible echo of the battles may be found in the biblical song of Deborah. The king came, they fought, then fought the kings of Canaan in Taanach by the waters of Megiddo. Found in Judges 5:19. Some of the most impressive archaeological remains in the country have been unearthed in the extensive excavations that have been taking place here for more than a century. They attest to the city's eminence, particularly during the Bronze Age and the Iron Age. History of the site. Flint tools and a few sherds discovered at Megiddo attest to human habitation at the site as early as the Neolithic period, the 7th and 6th millennia BCE, and in the Chalcolithic period, the 5th and 4th millennia. The Canaanite period. Megiddo flourished as an urban center beginning in the early Canaanite period, Bronze Age in the late 4th millennium, as attested by the impressive remains of a monumental temple. The annals of Thutmose III describe the battle that took place in the valley at the foot of Megiddo, in which the Egyptian army defeated the rebels, plundering hundreds of chariots, thousands of horses, and large quantities of grain. The arrival of the Egyptian army through the narrow Aruna Pass was also documented. After the battle, the Egyptians besieged Megiddo for 7 months until they conquered it. Among the 14th century BCE Amarna letters, a remnant of a late Bronze Age international archive discovered in Egypt, were 6 letters sent by King Biridi at Megiddo, at the time an Egyptian protectorate, to Pharaoh Akhenaton. In them, Biridia reports on the taxes he paid to the pharaoh and complaints of harassment by the king of Shechem. The Canaanite city of Megiddo was destroyed in the second half of the 12th century BCE. The Israelite period. The books of Joshua and Judges mention Megiddo as one of the Canaanite cities that the tribe of Manasseh was unable to take over. Joshua 17:11-13, Judges 1:27. However, Megiddo is also mentioned in the list of towns whose Canaanite kings Joshua defeated, Joshua 12:21. The Bible describes King Solomon's building of Megiddo together with Hazor and Gezer. And this is the account of the levy which King Solomon raised to build the house of the Lord, and his own house, and Milo, and the wall of Jerusalem, and Hazor, and Megiddo, and Gezer. 1 Kings 9:15. One opinion holds that King Solomon built a large city at Megiddo with 2 palaces with ashlar, or dressed stone walls. According to another view, these palaces were built in the 9th century by a king of the Israelite dynasty of Omri during the 8th century BCE. Israelite Megiddo reached the height of its prosperity. Impressive remains from this period include fortifications, stables, and a water system. During this period, Megiddo was the arena for the struggle between the kings of Judah and Israel. Near Megiddo, the Israelite King Jehu slew King Ahaziah of Judah after Ahaziah fled by the way of the garden house. 2 Kings 9:27. In 732 BC, the Assyrian King Tiglath-Pileser III captured the city and made it the capital of an Assyrian district that included the Galilee and the northern valleys. At the end of the 7th century, when the Assyrian Empire was in decline, The Egyptian Pharaoh Necho took over the region. On his orders, King Josiah of Judah was killed at Megiddo. 2 Kings 23:29-30. Touring route. Entrance pavilion. In the entrance pavilion built in the 1920s, visitors can view a 10-minute film on Megiddo's history and display about the excavations. The doorway to the display, which provides explanation about Megiddo and its site, is in the form of an ancient gate which represents Megiddo in the Canaanite period. One room contains a large model of the mound. The pavilion also houses a shop offering books, maps, and souvenirs, as well as a snack bar and restaurant. The first one is reservoir. The water source for Megiddo was a spring at the base of the hill on which this strategic city was built. From its early history, throughout the time of Solomon, the people reached the water by walking through a small postern gate and into a gallery, a roofed halfway that went down the side of the tell to the cave where the spring was located. The remains of this long, narrow extension of the city still exist where it passes through the city wall. This gallery provided security for the water supply. True, during a siege, that enemy could still destroy it and prevent the inhabitants from reaching it. Scholars believe that sometime during the 9th century BC, Ahab is considered a likely candidate for having the vision to initiate this project. A square vertical shaft was dug in the southwestern corner of the tell through the many layers of the earlier settlement and bedrock to a depth of more than 115 feet. It was connected to a horizontal tunnel that went underneath the city to the cave where the spring was located.
And I feel like they probably didn't have railings.
No,
not at all.
Kind of like the grain bin.
The next is the Canaanite city gate. Flanked by four chambers, the gate was built during the late Canaanite period. At that time, the city was not fortified, which means that the gate was ceremonial rather than defensive. It served as the entrance to the palace complex of that period. During its last phase, when ovens were built in its chambers, the gate probably served as a kind of service wing of the palace. The gate went out of use after the palace was burnt at the end of the late Canaanite period. The first course of the gate, which came into contact with the ground, was faced with slabs of basalt, more durable than the limestone of which the rest of the gate is built. The excavation unearthed the charred remains of olive wood beams that had been inserted between the courses of stone. The gate was preserved to a considerable height, and therefore during conservation it didn't have to be raised by much. A concrete line marks the beginning of the reconstructed portion. New wooden beams were inserted in the wall, and the stone pavement in the passage was completed for the convenience and safety of visitors. Adjacent to the Canaanite city gate is the Canaanite palace. On the other side of the Canaanite gate, on the right, is a massive stone wall, 2 meters thick, the sole remnant on the site of the palace of Megiddo's Canaanite ruler. The palace was built during the Middle Canaanite period, reaching its greatest size and opulence in the late Canaanite period. It was a huge structure in local terms. The portion unearthed in the excavations measured 50 by 30 meters. Its plan, with a central open courtyard surrounded by rooms and smaller courtyards, was influenced by contemporaneous Syrian architecture. Basalt steps alongside the stone wall were part of the street that ascended from the city gate to a plaza in front of the palace. The palace was destroyed in a conflagration in the mid-12th century BC. An assemblage of hundreds of carved ivory artifacts was discovered in one of its rooms, dubbed the treasure room by the excavators. The assemblage attests to the status of Megiddo's rulers at the time. Another sign of the ruler's eminence can be seen in the seashell flooring of one of the vestibules leading to the central courtyard and the remains of colored plaster to the courtyard walls. Most of the palace walls were removed during the excavations exposed earlier strata. However, the southern portion of the palace has not yet been excavated. Ascend the wooden steps and move forward in time. The Israelite Gate. Sometime after the destruction of the late Canaanite period, the late Bronze Age, the city was rebuilt, preserving the Canaanite character of its inhabitants and material culture. During the period of the Israelite monarchy, the city once again attained importance and was extensively built up and fortified by the Israelite kings. Here you can see remains of the city gate from the time, which was incorporated into the fortifications. A two-chambered outer gate was situated at the top of a ramp that ascended to the city from the north. The inner gate, you see here, had six chambers, and it was connected to the outer gate by an L-shaped plaza. Some scholars believe this structure was merely the foundation of the inner gate. A staircase descended from the outer gate to the reservoir. Scholars once attributed the gate to King Solomon. However, Megiddo's present-day excavators believed was built later during the reign of Jeroboam II in the 8th century BC. The western part of the inner gate was removed during the excavation. The remaining eastern part of the gate was built of ashlars. The central chamber has not yet been excavated. The northern stables. Two stable complexes were found at Megiddo, one on the northeastern part of the mount and one in the southwest. They reveal Megiddo's importance as a cavalry base or a center for commerce in horses. The construction of the stable city is attributed to one of the Israelite kings, perhaps Jeroboam II in the 8th century BCE, or to King Ahab in the 9th century BCE. Some scholars believe that the stables were used for other purposes, as storehouses, markets, or army barracks. On the left part of a stable can be seen including pillars and mangers. This northern part of the complex included 12 stables. The southern part was removed by the Chicago expedition to reach the level of the early Canaanite period, the early Bronze Age. The Tel Aviv University expedition completed the excavation of the stables and uncovered an impressive portion of the southern facade of the northernmost stables, which is slated for conservation and reconstruction. Additional stables were discovered on the southern part of the mound. The stable walls were built of mud brick on a foundation of ashlars, some of which were probably robbed from the ruined northern palace. The large number of stables attest to a strong city government at the time they were built and to Megiddo's status as a major chariot city. The public granary. The structure before you is a huge silo, 7 meters deep and 11 meters in diameter. Its walls are lined with filled stones. Two staircases lead to the bottom, which was paved with pebbles. Kernels of wheat found between the stones, along with the remains of straw, identify the structure as a silo. Its volume was approximately 450 cubic meters, which means it could store about 1,000 tons of wheat. The silo was built by one of the last Israelite kings, or perhaps during Assyrian rule. Some scholars believe the granary was built together with the stables to store fodder for the horses. The Southern Palace. Nothing is left of the Southern Palace now except the courtyard and the gate you see here. The remains have been dismantled by the Chicago expedition to reach earlier strata. The plan of the Southern Palace resembles that of the Northern Palace near its outer gate. Schumacher discovered the seal with the inscription to Tushima, servant of Jeroboam. apparently referring to Jeroboam II. This is the earliest seal of an Israelite king discovered to date. Unfortunately, the original seal was lost, leaving only a drawing. The palace has been dated to the 10th century BCE, with some scholars dating it later to the 9th century BCE and the reign of King Ahab. Dwelling, two rows of three monolithic pillars, each are vestiges of a dwelling from the Israelite period. The building was planned as a four-room house, which was typical of sites from the Israelite period. The plan featured three parallel spaces, with a fourth space perpendicular to them. The side space were used for storage. The middle was an open courtyard, and the perpendicular space was the dwelling area. A small industrial zone near the dwelling was dated to the 11th and 10th century BCE. Administrative structure from the Israelite period. To the left of the path is an opulent complex near the city wall dating to the Israelite period, which served as either a palace or administrative building. Its walls were made of fieldstones, with only the corners dressed for structural reasons. Few of the walls have survived, however. The excavations unearthed seven proto-Ionic capitals. Such capitals, depicting a stylized date palm, were typical of public buildings in the Israelite period. The temple area or the sacred area. The deep trench visible from the observation point was dug by the Chicago Expedition. In the first section of the trench opposite the observation point, the mound's numerous strata can be seen. More than 20 cities excavated down to bedrock. Remains found in a depression in the bedrock go back as far as the Neolithic period. Finds from the early Canaanite period indicate the presence of a large un-walled settlement that stretched east toward the present-day road at the foot of the mound. Below, you can see Megiddo's cultic area from the 4th millennium BCE to the beginning of the Israelite period. In the early Canaanite period, a series of temples was built here continually, one atop at the other. The earliest, dating from the early Canaanite period, was a broad room structure with an enclosed courtyard. Paving stones discovered in the courtyard bore incised Egyptian style motifs, among them depiction of humans and animals. Another temple from later in this period is the most monumental structure of its time known in the Levant. Impressive, finely finished basalt offering the tables were sunken into the floor. Its 4-meter thick walls reveal the importance of the city as early as at the end of the 4th millennium BCE. This temple illustrates the process of urbanization underway in Canaan at the close of the 4th millennium. At the end of the early Canaanite period, three more temples were built over the earlier ones. They were at the Megaron type, consisting of an open entrance area leading to a large room whose roof was supported by two columns. A circular altar, 8 meters in diameter, predating the three temples, continued in use. Seven steps lead to the top of this altar, which survived to its full height and is clearly visible at the back of the largest of the three temples. Numerous animal bones were found at the base of the altar. At the beginning of the Middle Canaanite period, rites were performed in the open area. At the end of the period, a fortress-like tower temple was built over the remains of the above-mentioned three temples, featuring thick wall and entrance flanked by a pair of towers. The tower temple continued in use until the end of the Israelite period. With the complete destruction of the Canaanite city in the Israelite period, cultic practices ceased in the temple area after over 2,000 years. The Northern Palace, Palace 6000, beneath the Northern Stable Complex lay the remains of a square building featuring thick ashlar walls dating to the Israelite period too. It is similar in size and character to the central building of the contemporaneous Southern Palace. Megiddo's excavators therefore assume it was also built in the center of a large square courtyard surrounded by walls or rooms. The precise plan is difficult to reconstruct, however. Its facade probably faced south with a row of rooms in the northern and western side with plastered floors. Yigal Yadin suggested that the building was a palace from the time of King Solomon, based, among other things, on a description of Solomon's impressive building projects in the Book of 1 Kings. However, some scholars now date the palace to the time of King Ahab.